Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hi, I am Edwin Garcia. Welcome back. This is lecture 4 of week 1. Today we're going to talk about polarization losses. What we were discussing on the last lecture, we were talking about a means to benchmark the different type of chemistry, different types of batteries. This was done in terms of a map that on the x-axis it has energy density, on the vertical axis it has power density. And here we have different types of technologies ranging from the classic lead acid, nickel cadmium, nickel metal hydride, sodium nickel dichloride, and of course the ones we're focusing on this class, which is the lithium ion system, which depending on what type of application, you can have high energy density, relatively low power density, and as you increase the power density of the system, you decrease the power density of the system. And well, what you should find interesting is the fact that how as I take more and more energy out of my system, as I basically increase the current density and extract more power out of the system starts delivering less energy. It's like there's some energy losses as the system goes from a low current density application to a high current density application. And well, as a result of that, we get on one side, we can have that down here, the result that we, that this is a vertical line or almost straight, as you can see in all the applications, is because we're very close to the equilibrium response. And as we keep extracting the current, small current densities, what it will do is we'll add some sort of loss on how much energy can be extracted out of the system to the point where in the limit of a very large current density or a relatively larger current density, we will extract the power that we want at the expense of how much energy can actually be used. This energy as compared to the ideal, to the close to the equilibrium or time independent value, if you may, is a loss, okay? And that loss is a result of all the different parts, all the different contributions that a rechargeable battery may have. There are many ways in which this device is being packaged, and it is the packaging and on the chemistries associated to how this battery was processed that would lead to these losses, which could be very large. For example, the two main setups you can have here, one that is called the prismatic device. You can see, it has this almost square-like shaped. Inside is trying to show you the different contributions. It's a very engineered device in the sense that the packaging itself is meant to be light and protect you for anything that may be happening inside. You really don't want to be in contact with the contents because they can be very corrosive. You can see here, for example, the terminal leads. Positive and negative terminal leads, regions, internal regions that we will talk about, like separators, obviously the negative and positive electrodes. And the way this is packaged, you can think of it as almost like a lasagna where you have a layer of cathode material, where it, a layer of separator, the cathode, and then you fold that into itself and then fold it again, right? So that it has this like folding your blankets kind of way. Right, and that is one type of device. The other one is the cylindrical architecture, where what you have here is that both the positive and negative layers, again, they're sandwiched through the separator, and this one is actually wound about the cylinder, and one of the leads is connected here to the positive terminal, and another one is connected up here at the back. And you can already see several losses that impact on the delivered power density. Just from the weight perspective, you can see how all these different parts that are added into the system will indeed decrease the energy density, because here we're talking about how much energy we have put on the actual active material. And we're going to have to divide that by all the different additional components. And all these different contributions where the electrons have to flow through will account for these losses. Okay, and here what we're doing is just going through all the different contributions from the top down. Okay. Now let's look more closely inside the battery and what applies in this case to the internal contributions to the cylindrical architecture will apply also conceptually speaking to the prismatic architecture. Okay, so here you have a cross section, an X-ray, if you may, from a rechargeable battery as it was measured by Quinn Horn. Here you can see the different layers and you can also see the lead that I was telling you about. I mean, all the electrons have to flow through that, okay, and they have to go through that cap, okay? I'm sure you've seen that cap in your different applications. And the chemistry, the width, the thickness of this particular lead will be important to how much losses you will have through that particular terminal. Okay, you can see it from the top, okay, as well. And here you can see how, well, here you have this one most likely corresponds to that one over there, okay, and the one on the bottom you can see here on the other end, okay, and here through the back contact, all the electrons are being collected so that they go through the resistive load and maybe come back through the other lead so that they're redistributed to the whole thing, okay. Obviously, there will be some waste on how much energy is being used because you can see the spaces that were not being occupied. And those, of course, account for the additional energy contributions. Okay, and what we want is to subtract those contributions or account for them either by making this cable thicker to minimize the losses as it goes through that particular channel. Okay, or improve the chemistry of that material. Obviously, if we pick a chemistry that has a higher conductivity, that could raise our price. And if we make it smaller, so that we decrease our weight and the price that we're paying for this, we will also include additional ohmic losses that will also have some cost. So you can see, if you can try to save for cost, but then you will have some losses when it comes to the actual energy that you can store here. And well, here, what you have here is we're looking much closely to that region. And you can see here that the different layers that we were talking about, cathode, the current collector that it's really hard to see here, and the anode current collector and the anode, for each of these layers you have to account for. Now, let's look at it much more closely, and that structure that you have there. You can see now that as you look at one of these individual layers, we have the structure that we were discussing last class, where each of these contributions, see, you have here the cathode, the separator, and the anode, each of them connect directly to their own layer of conductive material so that the electrons, as they dissociate from the lithium ions cross from the anode to the cathode to the separator, and the electrons go through this lead, which will in turn go through every single of these contacts so that they're collected here or in the other contact, okay, and go through the lead, come back down, and the electrons will come down through this region to react with the same ions that cross the separator and were dissociated here so that they can intercalate into the cathode material, okay. Now, while that happens, those ions have to go through all these obstacles. On the cathode side, they have to go through an aluminum current collector. And on the back of the anode, they have to go through a copper current collector. Why are these not made out of the same material? Well, in some cases, some specific chemistries cannot be put in touch directly with the anode or the cathode material because it can corrode it. So in this case, copper was put in contact with this anode material because it's more stable, and aluminum is more stable. The aluminum current collector is more stable with the cathode material. So that it would actually become more stable as an entire structure, right? So as you see these structures assembling together, obviously if you make this structure very thin, you will gain an energy density because you will be using less volume occupied by the contacts, but then you will increase also, you could in principle decrease the conductivity, and as a result of that, well, then you have some losses, right? Now, if the electrons are only going through the thickness of the system, what will happen is you could have some advantages as to how much losses you will have by dropping the charge there, and the same in the other side. So you can see it's not as trivial as one would think. One has to account for all these additional contributions. Now, this is just another slide of the same thing, showing you that you not only have to account for the fact that the different phases of the anode, the separator, and the cathode, the losses as they go through the different back contacts, but even if you have a fully charged battery, as this lithium ion crosses from here to here, okay, it still has to go through whatever obstacles it may find in the middle, say through the separator, okay, and as the battery discharges, the ions have to percolate between the different particles, adding with that an additional contribution to the different losses that the materials will have. Conversely, on this end, as lithium has left this edge and making this particle completely depleted of active material, the particles in the back will require to contribute with more lithium. So those particles, as lithium is exuded, have to go around. The lithium has to go around those particles, and as the discharge proceeds, the particles in the back will have to go all the way around all the different particles. The lithium has to go all around the different particles, cross the separator, diffuse through all the different particles in the cathode material to react there. So the internal resistance of the battery is changing, and as you want to, you may want to increase the energy density by making this electrode thicker and packing more material that will increase the resistivity. And if you think about it qualitatively, what will happen is if you increase the thickness of the structure, you will have to account for the large diffusion path or the large transport path in both the cathode and anode. Okay, and of course you can always remove particles to make that diffusion path more straight, but that will have also its own impact on the performance of the system. And of course we will talk further a little bit more about that. Okay, in terms of, for those of you that are more familiar in terms of resistors and capacitors, you can think of, if you think of this one as just one electrode, where on this side you have the separator, and here you have the cathode, and on that side you have the anode, as the battery discharges, you're going to have a loss as a result of the separator region, so you clearly want to have that section, the separator, as thin as possible. Okay, and as the lithium traverses the separator and enters the active material, it'll basically be stored in one of the particles. That's why this little capacitor over here. But once this particle has been filled, or particles there have been filled, all it will leave is leave these obstacles behind that will increase the internal resistance of the system. So now lithium has to traverse all these particles until it finally reaches that particle that can still accommodate lithium, increasing with that linearly, if you may, linearly with distance, non-linear with how this charge is being stored in order to keep accommodating the lithium in the system. And of course, as the reaction proceeds, by the time you get to the end, the particles at the very back will contribute with the amount of lithium minus the losses associated to the separator, the losses associated to the material that has already been spent, and whatever additional other loss that may result from the reaction proceeding forward. Okay, now how does this translate to the voltage distribution? Okay, well, we already discussed the concept of a voltage versus capacity plot, and now that you know this additional detail as to where the losses come from, you can see how at the very beginning of the discharge, even for a low C rate curve such as this one, 0.2C, okay, you can see how at T equals zero there's a drop as a result of that reaction proceeding, and then coming down as a result of the, of course, if you remember the voltage difference between the cathode and the anode, here the anode starts to dominate, forcing the voltage to drop to the cutoff voltage, and that's where we stop. This is for a very, very slow, small C rate. If I increase my C rate to 1C, that is a battery that discharges in 1 hour, then you can see that at T equals zero, just from turning on my battery, that will have a vertical drop that is almost instantaneous, okay, as a result of all the ohmic contributions from all the LEDs, all the packaging of the battery, okay, the separator, and the distance that the electrons and the lithium ions have to go through corresponds to that loss. So you can see how you really want to keep that loss low, even at relatively low C rates, because this will determine whether or not you will deliver the amount of energy that you want to deliver, or the total amount of charge, right? And well, you can see the curve roughly follows the same thickness, right? The same capacity, except here you can see there's a tiny little loss that occurred as a result from the transport limitations by the material additional limitations, in this case as a result of diffusion. Now, if instead we go, say, to 3C, we have increased this loss linearly now from 0.2C to 3C, basically a factor of 3, okay? But now the internal transport limitations, the diffusion transport in the electrolyte will take over, and you can see how it becomes the loss will be very large, and so you will have to account for all of that. Okay, so overall, what accounts for the contributions to polarization to the material? Okay, what are those contributions that you should account when you are trying to consider the performance of a battery? Well, if I start by saying that the total voltage of the battery corresponds to the equilibrium potential, okay, where X in this case is the state of charge, okay, if I want to account for all the contributions, okay, the first one is going to be all the transport losses as a result of the internal microstructural features, that is how the particles inside the cathode and the anode are distributed throughout the electrolyte, in the electrode, or even in the separator. That contributes with a linear time-dependent contributions as the reaction proceeds. Okay, this is probably the most convoluted contribution to losses that a battery may have, okay, but it's not the only one. Okay, you may also find that there are losses across the back ohmic contacts, which it adds an additional subtraction from the voltage of the system. And here you can see the resistance of the system depends on how thick each of those contacts is. Okay, what materials is made out of is not the same to be using copper than using aluminum than using silver or than using gold. Okay, you really want to minimize these by making your electrodes, your back contacts, thin but highly conductive. And you also want to have them light, because that will also impact on what is the energy density of the system. The next one will be the interfacial losses, something we haven't talked about much, but it's important. The contact resistance and interfacial losses will become important. Why? Because the interfacial losses are as a result of the reaction that occurs right at the active material electrolyte interface. And these could be very large, and if that interfacial resistance is too large, even if you can have an equilibrium potential that could be very useful just from that interfacial material that forms between the active material and the electrolyte can completely kill your performance. Okay, we will talk about each of these individual contributions as we go, okay, and how the reaction occurring at the interface, the bulk contributions or the materials that you use to package them, can impact on the bottom line, which is how the voltage as a function of the charge will make you respond to the system. Okay, and what we will see on the next slide is we will discuss, on the next lecture, I'm sorry, we will summarize what we have learned this week, and on the next week we'll start talking about this contribution alone, because everything starts from being able to maximize the potential of the system. Okay, thank you.